Good morning. It's Sunday. It's 11 o'clock. It's time for Sunday Assembly.
Hey.
My name's Matt. I'll be your host for today. And while we're waiting for people to come in, why not drop your name in the chat and where you are? And just for a change, add a little fact about where you are. If you don't know any facts about where you are, just make something up, a complete lie, and we'll judge whether it's actually a true fact or not. Now then, for anybody who's here who hasn't been before, we've got talks, we've got performances, we've got poetry, we've got songs to wail along with, we've got community contributions, and it's like a whole veritable smorgasbord of awesomeness. And for the first time today, we've actually got closed captions as well. So that means that if you are having problems understanding me, which is entirely understandable, or want to know more from the speakers, you can click the closed caption button at the bottom of the screen and then show subtitles, and you'll be able to see what people are saying as well, which is remarkable. It's modern technology gone mad. So have we got any facts? We've got lots of facts. Stuart Holdsworth, I'm in Bow, and it's well known for taking its name from a bow-shaped bridge. I don't know. I'm going with that must be joking for that one. Tottenham, the best place in the world, from Ange. Again, that must be joking. Not a chance, because everybody knows that Brixton's the best place in the world. Good morning from Catford, Charmaine, the place with a giant black cat above the town centre. Aye, definitely. Catherine in Leighton, Buzzard. Fact is, it's not named after Buzzards the bird. It's named for Alfieu Buzzard in the 9th century, who founded an abbey here, which sounds totally, totally plausible. So, aye, just making me say words I can't pronounce. Eva in the Sticks, which is actually Hildenborough. Dame Kelly Holmes lives here, and she has alpacas. Kelly Holmes, yes. Alpacas, don't know. So, aye, but that must be joking. The Smurfs come from Catford, according to Mark Newbrook. Not sure. I'm in Hornsey and live between a mosque and... Oh, it scrolls too fast. A church, canal, and train depot. That sounds entirely plausible. So aye. Claire in Finsbury Park, where the croissant was first invented. I mean, everybody thinks it's the French, but it's daft enough, isn't it? It's daft enough that it could be true. So aye, go on then. So yeah, that's... I shouldn't go on because that'll take forever. So we should probably kick off. Already done the introduction. We're going to have songs. We're going to have talks. We're going to have poetry. And remember, closed captions at the bottom of the screen. New feature. It's only taken us a year to get there. But now we'll go on to the first song. And with a theme like what we've got today, there's really only one song we could kick off with. So here we go. First a song from the band, and then a song from the choir.
It's a god-awful small affair to the girl with the mousy hair. Though her mommy is yelling no, and her daddy has told her to go, but her friend is nowhere to be seen. As she walks through her sunken dream to the seat with the clearest view, and she's hooked to the silver screen. But the film is a saddening bore, for she's seen it 10 times or more. She could spit in the eye of fools as they ask her to focus on sailors fighting in the dance hall. A look at the lawman leading up the
I say, chaps, what's better than one song?
Oh,
Space. The final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Sunday Assembly. Its ongoing mission to build secular communities, to seek out new speakers and performers, to live better, help often, and wonder more. There you go, Star Trek and 90s rave music, arguably the best combination of things in the world. Thanks to Steph for wailing there. That was some high-pitched wailing. Anyway, if anybody does want to join the band or the choir and get involved with the music, get in touch. We're always welcome to new musicians, new singers, and so on. And by the way, this costs £5, supposed to be a space helmet. Kind of makes me more look like a duck, but you know, worst £5 I've ever spent. Anyway, moving on, what's next? Right, next up, a person who we couldn't really have a science-themed assembly without. They're a physicist, a climate science researcher, and the 2019 UK Slam Poetry Champion, and you know, it's perfect, isn't it? So handing over to Robin Lamball.
Hello, everyone. Hopefully you can all hear me. Good. I'm saying good as though you've reacted. I actually don't know, but I'm assuming you have because no one shouted. They can't yet. I'm going to do some poems mostly about life on Earth, but in the context of space. So I'm going to start off with explaining how you can tell there is life on Earth from looking at our atmosphere. And you can do an experiment for this. You just breathe, and if you don't die after about 4 minutes, probably you're on a planet with life on it, so that's good. This poem explains how we know that. It's called Sea Anemones. Some cells see anemones as being their enemies, but several sorts of algae are hardly separate entities. They, in a process called endosymbiosis, live inside their hostess, closeness without protest, swapping their sweet sugars for the safe seats it delivers, protected by these toxic spines if they should need assistance. But this curious pedigree found inside the anemone goes another layer deeper. See, the algae all are Russian dolls that once ate other algae that hold chloroplasts, which in the past lived on their own. These now harmless creatures back then were known as cyanobacteria and caused such hysteria when they first fouled the earth with this toxin that we call oxygen. Highly reactive, it found life, attacked it. The bodies piled higher till we learned to respire. What was waste was endorsed and was made a resource. Now we breathe these exhaust fumes as we all consume food made by these awesome bacterial communes, because not all were digested. Some just arrested inside a cell, where in good health they photosynthesize, barely realize as feeder and fouler become one alga. Inside an anemone and in and around this could be a clownfish, and they're all trying to kill each other. Remember, these sea anemones don't dance purely by chance, and they're not plants. They're poison stinging, paralysis or death bringing animals. Only Nemo's immune to his sting harpoon. His mucus coat means he can gloat safe from predation, luring snacks into his own habitation, because phenomenally, this lemony green anemone seems cleaned by a nominally prey species as they both breathe poison oxygen from within. It seems home is where you're immune to the neurotoxin. I'm going to do a second poem. This perhaps relates a bit more closely to the theme of aliens. So we're getting to the end of lockdown. And if you're like me, you had a lot of goals for lockdown, things you meant to do, because you couldn't do all of the things that you'd normally expect to do in this year of your life. And now there's a feeling you haven't done those, and it's kind of disappointing. The Germans have a word for this called Torschluss panic, fear of closing doors. The idea that like your life is slipping away from you and you just can't do all of the things that you want to. So this is a poem about how aliens can help with that. When we observe the far stars to see if the whole universe curves right round, we conclude it doesn't. And if it has no center, this suggests our flatness continues forever. And if we truly live in an infinite universe, then every pattern of atoms infinitely recurs. So there are infinite clones of you, all like you, but worse. Yous winning all competitions on planets, all called Earth, who tick up their whole bucket list and stick by their nutritionalist, some even looking up to see what look like the same stars, just a few trillion, 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 trillion light years away from ours. So to my clones, I trust that some of you will do all the things I wanted to, but didn't. We'll notice that no feat can make you unique, but that some may be fun. That you too will know, in all this vastness, no one and nothing can be special, except to the people who will only ever be special to you. Thank you.
Ah, brilliant, Robin. Always, always brilliant. After the main speaker, we're going to have a Q&A. The main speaker can't hang around too long afterwards, so we're going to have a Q&A afterwards. So drop your questions in there. We may get Robin to answer some as well. So if you want to ask a question, please drop a question in there during the main talk. And going on to the main talk, we've got the founder of Rap Science. He's worked with NASA, the Science Museum, the BBC. He's written books, including The Science of Star Wars. So not much more to say. Hand over to John Chase.
Hi, guys. How are you doing? I hope everybody is okay. And I'm looking forward to today, actually, because I was asked to join in this and the Sunday Assembly. And I said, what's it all about? Let me know. So having seen it's full of curious minds, I'm absolutely honoured and happy to be able to come and speak to all of you guys. So today I've been asked to talk about Mars and then the Perseverance mission that has recently occurred. So I'll just try and put this presentation through together now so you can see it. So let's have a go at that. Click that button, share. Hopefully everyone should be able to see everything. So can everyone see it okay? Fantastic. So you might have heard of the Mars 2020 mission. If not, what rock have you been hiding underneath? Come on, guys. Like, this is like literally the latest mission to Mars from NASA. And it was all launched in a tight window recently. And they weren't the only mission that went. There was also a mission from the United Arab Emirates and also a mission from China to Mars. So there were three missions sent and they've all got there and got into orbit. And the Mars Perseverance has actually landed on the surface. Now, let me give you a little bit of insight into that mission. So you may have heard of the Curiosity rovers from before, many different rovers they had before, for example, Sojourn as well was one of the earlier ones. But this particular rover, Perseverance, is about the size of a car. And it had to be sent via a huge rocket, obviously it's the size of a car, all the way to Mars. Now, to do that, you need to get to a certain speed, which is about 25,000 miles per hour, which is extremely fast. Think you'll agree. Now, the question might be, why do we go all the way to Mars? Why don't we just stay here, or maybe even go to Venus, or maybe the other planets? Well, the main reason is everywhere's too far. Everywhere's really far. For us to go and actually go and explore somewhere, we'd have to travel a huge distance through space to keep people alive. So the plan is to actually get feet on the ground on these planets eventually. But before they do that, it's wiser to send something that's, well, not likely to die. like a robot. Robots will die in their own way, but not die a horrible death like a human would. So you don't want to send a human first, you want to send something to kind of scout it out, hence the robots. So we've sent robots to Mars and Venus. I say we, but I don't know if anyone here is actually rocket engineers. It wasn't me, I didn't send it personally, you know, it was humans. All right. And the first people to ever send something to save Venus were actually the USSR, Russia. They were the first to send things to most places in space, actually, to the moon, to Venus. And the problem is when they sent something to Venus, it went in and they didn't realize just how hot and dangerous it was. Yes, Venus is hot and it is dangerous. When people talk about aliens potentially staying, living in a different planet, you wouldn't think Venus, because Venus is basically disgusting. It rains acid, 2 times hotter than your oven. The pressure's so intense, it could crush a submarine. It's just a horrible place, okay? The pressure, like there's millions of ways that Venus is trying to kill you. Don't go to Venus, right? So you wouldn't expect to find life there. Although the University of Cardiff think they have found signs of life in lurking in the atmosphere on Venus. But when we say life, we don't think big tentacles flying around or flappy birds. It's more tiny, tiny, potentially bacteria that would be in the upper atmosphere. So maybe Venus, but very unlikely because it's just trying to kill you. So let's look at Mars. So Mars is the better option, okay? So Venus is about the same size as Earth. Mars is smaller. Venus has the same gravity. Mars has less gravity, but we'd still be okay there. We could still function. We functioned on the moon, and the moon has less gravity than Mars. So Mars is a reasonable option, right? It's cold. It's very cold. Thermal underwear all the time. In some parts, in the hottest parts, it can get to, say, about 30 degrees, but generally its average temperature is about minus 50 degrees. And sorry, everybody, I've just remembered that I have to slow down because we've got somebody taking captions. And I tend to get really excited when I talk and talk very fast to get it all out. But I'm going to slow down now and probably get through a bit less, okay? So I'm gonna cut to the chase on this one. Mars is smaller than Earth. The gravity is a bit less. It's generally cold. Its atmosphere is mostly carbon dioxide, about 95%. Not much oxygen, not a place we could go and breathe, okay? And we have recently discovered that there likely is water on Mars, but not in the form of liquid water, but as ice, okay? And potentially subsurface, there are also caps, ice caps. So let's look at NASA's main missions. Why are they going to Mars? Well, they had 4 main missions for going into space. One was to follow the water, because anywhere we find water on planet Earth, we find life. And so if we wanted to find life on another planet, we want to find signs of water. They also want to prepare for human exploration. They want to explore the chances of finding life, that's habitability, and they want to seek signs of life. Okay, so they want to explore how likely life is to be there. Okay, so basically, when you're looking for life in space, it's a type of science called astrobiology. Now, being a rapper, I write raps about different things. I did do a rap for NASA a while back. And so when I was speaking to the organizers earlier, they said, oh, God, we'd love to see your raps. So I thought, you know, in 15 minutes, the raps can be long. I'd shy away from the raps and just give you the info, but actually, you want raps. And that's exactly what you will get. So instead of me telling you what astrobiology, which is the search for life in space, I might as well give you a song. And this is it. So I hope you enjoy it. This is the rap I done for NASA back in 2008 called Astrobiology.
Up until the 1920s, everyone thought the universe was essentially static and unchanging in time. Then it was discovered that the universe was expanding. The questions I would like to talk about are, where did we come from? How did the universe come into being? Are we alone in the universe? Is there alien life out there? What is the future?
Some of the biggest questions that's ever been asked. Do you know where life is going? Can you tell where it starts? We've been on Earth for many years and we are still producing answers. As time passes, collective knowledge advances. We set targets, erase hopes for the future. With mathematical modelling on the computer, bring statistics to make it hard to dispute the length of time it took life to evolve here. The origin of life is hotly debated. Some say evolved, some say created. The choice is up to you, it just depends on how you weigh it. Did life start on Earth and it's all life related? To differentiate the life forms into species. Now it's just a label, DNA in the deep freeze. Gotta complete these genome family trees. Fundamental for pondering these. Study life on Earth, then you're doing biology. But in space it's called looking for life in the rest of the galaxy with interplanetary. The origins of life, still don't know the chronology. But digging up clues with I didn't know about. But now I'm here to chat about.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
Well, this question is in doubt. 1957, check the date when Russia launched Sputnik, starting the space age. Two superpowers and a Cold War mandate. A year later, NASA's foundations were laid. Part of the first step, rockets need an upgrade. No travel by the end of the next decade. Are we looking for life? Nah, not on this landscape. Where should we look? Better ask Van Drake. Let's try to find a star similar to the sun, and where we might find a planet similar to our own, where conditions are perfect in a Goldilocks zone. What about planet X? We better leave that alone. The further from the heat source, the colder the home. But life can survive in extremes, so the evidence has shown. To find alive, not intelligence and genetic inheritance, but alien communication, how would we know? Study life on Earth, then you're doing by biology, but in space it's called astrobiology. Looking for life in the rest of the galaxy with interplanetary astrobiology. The origins of life, still don't know the chronology, but digging up clues with astrobiology. I didn't know about astrobiology, but now I'm here to chat about astrobiology. Astronomy, monotony for some, but still the mind is always wondering, searching for extraterrestrial intelligence. We listen to radio, but the signal stays silent. Only alien I've seen is in a science fiction story, in an alien autopsy or some other type of movie. So look for the biology and not the mythology. It's eyes into space for some astrobiology. Use methodologies to determine the distance to stars and how hot they're burning. But when I say Doppler, I'm not speaking German, I'm referring to a shift in the light spectrum. From all the methods, this could be the best one to find big worlds in other star systems. Exoplanets that fit the description. Is anyone there? Well, that's the question. Study life on Earth, then you're doing biology. But in space, it's called astrobiology. Looking for life
in the rest of the galaxy with interplanetary astrobiology. The origins of life still don't know the chronology. Digging up clues with astrobiology. I didn't know about astrobiology, but now I'm here to chat about astrobiology.
So indeed, I am here to chat about astrobiology. And in particular, why NASA's... Oh, look, don't worry about the helicopters, guys. They must have been talking about what's happening. Someone rapping about astrobiology, perhaps. But so that was a little rap that I done a while back for NASA. They asked me to do it just to talk about astrobiology, so I did. And that was what I came up with. Now, I'm going to try and give you an idea of why and what they're trying to do on Mars, okay? So they've landed in a particular spot, and they're looking for signs of water. Now, the water isn't there anymore, but it used to be in the past, okay? Billions of years ago. If you look at this thing that says EZD's Planitia, it's a region on Mars, and you can see how tall or short it is. The taller parts are red and the lower parts are blue, okay? If you zoom in on that place on the right, the blue circle looks like a lake. It indeed used to be a lake. And they landed in a place called the Jezero Crater. You can see in the middle, there's a circle, and that shows you where the crater is. And then in the top right, there's a zoomed in image of that. And
sorry. We're still seeing the video at the moment, I think. We can't see any
of it. Oh, my gosh. Oh, see, that's technology. Let me slow down. Okay. Let me see where you are now. What can you see?
Still you in the car doing the video, I think. Unless it's just me who can see that.
I'm about to try something magical here. Has it stopped?
No.
What's going on? Okay. I know. We stop sharing and then start sharing again. Okay. I'm glad you told me that because I would have just been talking. And I can talk, believe me. Oh, gosh. So can I just check? My battery's telling me I've got 5%, so I'm going to do something about that in a second. I tell you what, I've got a plan. Do you guys want to see another rap? Yeah? This one is about the Apollo missions. I hope you enjoy. I'm going to put on this rap, then we'll get back to me talking while I go and get my charger. If that's okay for everyone? All right. So this should work. Share screen. Versatility for the win. Okay, let's try that. Okay, so hopefully this is the Apollo rap called Moonshot. I'll be back.
Baby.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon
in this decade and do the other thing. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Have you ever climbed a big hill to touch the sky or watch the light of the moon bathe the countryside? We'll take flight like Jules Verne's De La Terre à la Lune, cause we're imagining the journey from the earth to the moon. Is there a man on the moon? Could be a rabbit to be honest, or a dame made of Edam with the name of a goddess like Diana Chang'e or Luna. But by night, a moon by any other name would shine as bright. So we learned how the moon reflects light from the sun rays, depending on the angle that we see it in space. And the length of a month comes from adding the days that it takes the moon to cycle through every phase. But it's always the same side that faces us, because the lunar rotation is synchronous with the time that it takes to get around the earth. That's why the far side of the moon had never been observed.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
Fast forward and we're caught in a cold war with nuclear weapons, big rockets and so forth. Two major powers setting sights for space, but then Sputnik flies over like in your face. So let the space race begin. The Soviets embarking with an animal in orbit and then Yuri Gagarin. And with their lunar program, they became the first to get a spacecraft to the moon and down to its surface. Now a little nervous, but still in the race. Busy pioneering missions, it's United States. Then NASA put rangers and surveyors in the sky before man in a can, Mercury and then Gemini, Gemini. The first space rendezvous followed. The NASA was just over the moon with Apollo. They walked on the surface in 69, returning
safely to the Earth
as the first in line.
That's one small step for man, one
After the race for space, feeling routine.
We've had a problem here.
Apollo 13, putting the 4 into 14. A shepherd's playing golf while the next mission saw the moon buggies taking off. The last was 17 in 1972, where our blue marble planet got entirely viewed. But only two nations flew to the moon so far. Both us as in US and USSR. Now a few decades on and Japan's on the map, with ESA and India who all made an impact. But then China landed a rover, a moment of pride in 2019. They put the first on the far side. Now Israel got to the moon but crashed. Small country, big dreams, but their hopes were dashed. Now the future aspiration isn't bound to any nation, just whoever's got the vision, the money and dedication.
I choose to go to the moon. I choose to go to the moon with artists.
Okay. So I've stopped it, but I'm just waiting to see if my voice is currently talking over the end of the video or not. Am I okay to carry on?
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, brilliant. Look at that. Right, right. So, okay. So I'm just going to quickly do this so I can put this presentation back into position. Okay. I should probably share again. Apologies for this, people. There we go. So share my screen again. I hope you enjoyed that wrap. Okay, here we go. All right, so this is the place. I hope you can see it now. This place called Isidis Planitia. You can see the arrow pointing at it, and it's that blue circle in the middle. The blue apartment.
No, we've still got a black screen at the moment. It just says John Chase has started screen sharing. There's no pictures.
Oh dear, what is going on? I've got no idea. I'm guessing this is something from, I have no way of solving this. The video worked. Is it still just saying that?
Yeah, it wouldn't be Sunday assembly without tech problems.
I know, what is happening? Okay, so let's see if I can do this another way. I'm going to share my screen a total different way and make it happen, because that's what we do. Okay, so let me just click there. Okay, what are you seeing right now?
Just the same. It could be a bandwidth issue. It says you've got low bandwidth as well.
Okay. I'm not sure of any other way to do it except just to talk. And we don't need no stinking presentation out the window. Okay, so basically, we've sent a probe, a mission to the planet Mars, and it's gone to a particular place. It's a crater on Mars where they believe water used to sit inside that crater, okay? The mission landed on February the 18th. After careering through the atmosphere and sending down the rover on the bottom of a tether, and then the top part flew away and left the rover left on the planet. And the rover was called Perseverance. It's about the size of a car, and it's got lots of cameras on it and equipment to actually look at Mars close up, as in look at the surface. And also it's got drilling apparatus. This is one of the missions where they want to drill into the ground and return the stuff they drill out back to Earth. And to do that, they're going to send another mission in the next 10 years to go and collect that stuff off of the surface. Now, the reason they're going to this lake area is because there used to be water there. And like I said earlier, wherever you find water on the planet or on planet Earth, you find life. And so the question would be, was there life on Mars when there was water there? Now, the thing is, there's no water there now. Well, not liquid water, it's ice on the polar caps or under the surface, called subsurface. So they're looking for signs of life that used to live on the planet. And they can find those signs visible in the rocks. And signs of life might be, for example, going to a beach and finding lots of garbage there, like Coca-Cola cans, crisp packets. And you'd be like, there were people here at one point, but there's none here now. It's the same thing for ancient life, okay? Although ancient life, the little tiny bacteria, they don't leave crisp packets and stuff. they leave the things that are left over after they've finished eating and stuff. And we call them biomarkers or signs of life, okay? And so they're looking to drill into the ground and analyze those samples to find the signs of life that used to live there. So that's why they go into that particular crater called Jezero Crater. And that's what this whole mission is about, to find signs of life and also to look for the possible chances for people to visit there later. And that's where I'll probably stop now because I haven't got a presentation to show you some of the images. So it might be too many words just going in and coming out. But if you've got any questions, that might be easier to directly answer questions. But I'm aware we're maybe a few minutes over, so I'll leave.
We're running a little bit late, but I'm sure we can get a couple of questions in. We've got mostly about astrobiology, the ones that have come in, of course. what we got? Would life on other planets be based necessarily on DNA? We've got questions from Jonathan Ashton here.
Great question, Jonathan. So the thing about the problem is that we've only got one place, one example of life, and that's planet Earth. And what scientists desperately need is somewhere else where life is found to see if life forms the same way everywhere, or if it's just the Earth type of life that forms. So on Earth, we believe everything's related. Everything came from common ancestor, okay? So there was initially lots of different bacteria, and over time they spread and they varied to become different life forms. And you fast forward that many billions of years, you've got all of the different wonderful types of life form we've got on the planet now. And they all share the same type of system, which is RNA and DNA. But we're not sure if that would be the case if we found life. Mitski, that's funny. Donald Trump, don't be so harsh about saying you're not related to him, because you are, unfortunately, because he's human. We all are. That's right. We can't escape it. We're all related. Good or bad, we just got to embrace it, you know. So if we found life on Mars, we'd be able to first look to see if it's similar to on Earth, if it has the same developments. And then we'd be able to answer the questions of, if it is the same, is there a chance that life potentially moves from Earth to Mars or from Mars to Earth in a distant past? It's a theory called panspermia. It's not confirmed, but people are looking into the possibility of microbes piggybacking on a meteor asteroid from one planet to the other. So if a big collision hits a planet, it's enough to send bits of rock into the atmosphere, up into space, and those could eventually come to Earth. So we don't know. So that's the question. So we want to find out. Good question, okay. Though.
Cool. So tying in with that question, and just really a two-parter here, is where in the universe in the galaxy would we be most likely to find these other forms of life, and is there anything that lives on Earth that could survive on Mars?
Well, there probably is quite a few different types of bacteria on Earth that could survive on Mars. It wouldn't be the biggest problem. I think it's the main thing is that there's so many different things you need for more complex life that when we talk about life, we often think about things that we see moving around, or even maybe even the smallest little bugs, but actually they're actually bacteria, the most likely things. And there's also, we have planetary officers who, when we send probes to other planets, we have to make sure that there's no bacteria on these probes, because there's a chance that we will actually send life forms to those planets that will land and start to flourish. And so we don't want to do that, because it would spoil any type of chances of finding life that actually is there. And the life we send there by accident might actually take out all of the life that's there already. So there are chances of life on Earth surviving on Mars, mainly bacteria. And when you asked what's the most likely place we'd find life in the galaxy, well, scientists believe it's planets that are potentially similar to ours that have liquid water on the surface. But there are so many factors that were in play to have us on this planet as it is. For example, even the presence of our moon affected our potential to survive on this planet. And so the tilt of the Earth, the seasons, there's so many things. But water is a prime candidate. And to find water on a planet has to be a certain distance from its star, mostly in what's called the Goldilocks zone or the habitable zone.
Cool. Everybody in the comments is writing, what about tardigrades?
Tardigrades. No, see, tardigrades are amazing. So tardigrades can exist in the vacuum of space. So they basically sent these poor things up, then open up the doors and expose them to space with all its cosmic rays, with the temperatures and the lack of oxygen, and they survived. But it's important to note that they didn't send it up crawling around. They have a particular state of their life called cryptobiosis, which basically means it's really cold life. And they kind of imagine like a wood lice growing into a ball. And these guys kind of get rid of all their water and kind of just go into a form of stasis. And that's how they survive in space. They're not surviving moving around. They can't survive out there like that. All the water would get sucked out of their body. But before they're out there, they kind of send all of the liquid out. They become dehydrated and go into a state of cryptobiosis. Then when they bring them back down and bring them to Earth, they add the water again. And over time, they kind of grow again and then start doing what animals do, if you catch my drift. And then they continue flourishing.
Brilliant, brilliant. Thanks. I wish we had more time, actually. You know, technical problems, and oh, I know you've got to get off. And
no, I'll tell you what. I can actually hang around somewhere, but I'll be off screen. So any more things, if you want to catch me at the end, you could potentially do it. I'll just attend to everything in the meantime, because there's so many technical glitches, and I love just answering questions if I possibly can. So I definitely will answer as many other questions as I can, as long as it takes.
Oh, so, brilliant.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks so much for doing that. But yeah, we've got to move on because we've got so many more bits to do. The next thing, we always have a moment of silence, a moment of reflection to think about what we've heard. Sometimes it's deep and heavy stuff to think about, but we can think about tardigrades for a minute or two if we really want to. At the end of that, Patania's put a piece of music together to bring out of it that is totally appropriate. So yeah, moment of reflection. Thanks. And of course, unmute. So yeah, Tanya was up till like midnight putting that together. So thanks so much. Moving on. Next up, we've got, I believe, Annie with the notices.
Thanks, Matt. Oh, we're getting started. Oh, actually, is it me? It's me, but it's not this much I know. It might be Rona next. It might be Rona. Rona, I think it might be you. I'll pass over to you.
It is me.
Oh, sorry.
Somebody got the running order wrong, but we changed it at the last minute. So, you know, I'll let you off. But, yeah, it is me next, and then Annie with the notices after me. Sorry, guys. This much I know. I've been asked to talk for 5 minutes about what I've learned in life, particularly want to focus on the fact that we've been talking a lot about Mars and about what's out there in our great universe and the possibilities of life on other planets and so on. And then I want to sort of bring us all back down to Earth for a moment. This much I know is basically a summation of what we've learned as individuals as we journey through life. And what I will say is that I was born into a society which has increasingly, particularly in the last 40 years, become based on neoliberal political principles. And for those who are not clear as to what neoliberalism is, it's the focus and the emphasis on the individual to succeed in life and to pit one individual against each other. And if the person has not achieved what they are meant to achieve within a certain period of time, it is their fault. And society takes the blame away from itself and focuses on individual attainment and achievement, which creates an extremely negative and very very uncollectivist mentality. As human beings, we do need each other. We are interdependent, and to take all of that away is particularly exacerbated by COVID over the last year, where we're all having to mask and stay away from each other. It's that's the ideal of neoliberalism sort of taken to the ultimate extent. So COVID is a gift for governments that support the emphasis. Like myself, you are considered to be not as good as the average non-disabled person. Your life isn't worth as much. At the beginning of COVID, there was a priority scale, and those who were fittest and healthiest were top of the list for saving the life of the person who was fittest and healthiest at the priority scale. And as you got older and more disabled, you slipped less and less down the scale. I was about a 5 on the scale of people whose lives were worth saving. And if you are 90 years old and say you have dementia, then you are number 10 on the category scale. So what I'm trying to say is that over the course of my life, I learned that, well, I need to get a job at the end of June, for example, because I have a fixed-term contract. But although there aren't that many jobs for life anymore, there aren't that many permanent jobs going. The culture of the workplace has become increasingly geared towards what is known as the gig economy, where you have no rights. You come in and you have no particular sort of things like a pension scheme or a subsidized gym, or, you know, whatever the perks were of working in a particular place, you know, 30, 40 years ago, those perks are gone. You come in, you do your job, and if you get sick, too bad, you don't get paid. And that's the kind of, you know, it's a very sort of disposable, temporary type of job situations that are out there. So hopefully, permanent jobs do exist, and hopefully I'll obtain one, or perhaps another fixed term contract. But what I'm trying to say is that I live in a world that doesn't particularly welcome anyone who is older or is physically impaired, or not everyone is valued for their own skills and abilities. We don't value each other as individuals. We pit each other. We're pitted against each other in the political context as individuals. And then came COVID. And then COVID, as I said, was the ultimate attempt to separate us. But what happened was we came together. We formed mutual aid groups. We formed the Sunday assembly groups. We formed clubs online. We carried on living virtually. And what do I do for a living? I sing, I lead choirs, and I've discovered singing online, and I've discovered doing drama online. And I discovered that as a disabled person, it's a lot easier for me to go online and to lead a project than to actually travel to a venue and spend that money, you know, on photocopying lyrics for a choir and doing all the things I was doing before. Life has become a lot easier for me. So conversely, although COVID has brought us apart, it's sort of made life easier for some of us. And it's brought us together because of mutual aid groups and groups at the Sunday Assembly and so on. So I'll just basically conclude by saying this much I know. Human beings are complex. We're a mixture of good and evil. And I think there was an anecdote I read a while ago about a wolf. A person had two wolves inside of them, the greedy, selfish wolf and the kind and loving wolf. And one of them is going to survive and one of them is going to die. And they asked the old wise man, which wolf will survive and which one will die? And the wise man replies, the one that you feed. So COVID has fed some of us, it obviously government in the greedy sense, and some of us have come together, like on Sunday Assembly, in the kind and loving sense of realizing that we're not individuals, that we are. I put into the comments earlier when we were talking about being related to Donald Trump. We are one. We are all one. We are all connected. We are all related to each other, and we are all one consciousness, seeing the world in very objective, very sort of subjective ways. Please, as you go on with the rest of your day today, please remember that in some respects we're all one. We are all interconnected. So I'm probably going to finish there. I'm going to finish on a positive note because I don't think that I could possibly be the only person here who believes that there is hope for our society if we recognize our the fact that we have more in common than what divides us, and the fact that we are all connected in some way. And that gives me hope that perhaps I do have some sort of future. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Rona. Lots to think about there. There is more that connects us than divides us, which I think is actually one of Sunday Assembly East End's little mottos. So nice there. Totally sorry for screwing up the running order there. That was a section called This Much I Know, or Trying My Best, where we get somebody from the community to share their thoughts about something they're going through or something they're trying to do. Sorry again. Just can't read today. And anyway, as I said earlier, and I'm supposed to say now, over to Annie for the notices.
Thank you so much, Matt. Well, I personally loved it. I got to show my face twice now, and that's fantastic. Thank you so much. Rona, it was absolutely a privilege to be to follow on from you, and that was absolutely amazing. Thank you so much, and what amazing speakers and poetry we have heard today. So yeah, talking about opportunities, I suppose, unfortunately, the way that Sunday Assembly works, unfortunately, fortunately, whichever way you want to look at it, but drawing on from what Rona was saying, we have opportunities of volunteering, not paid, unfortunately, but volunteering nevertheless, which is at the core of everything that Sunday Assembly does. And without our volunteers, we would not be able to do this. We wouldn't be able to offer all of those ways of connecting So this is a real pleasure to be sharing this. I wish they were paid. I genuinely wish they were paid. But for that, we would need to be making big bucks. Anyway, moving back, there are several opportunities on our website, which we would love for people to come forward for. These are involved in bringing the events together, like the choir director. Tanya and Emma have done an absolutely phenomenal job, but we need more help, and you could direct our choir if that's something that you have a musical background and you would love to do that. That would be amazing. PowerPoint presentation, we've got Stephen, who is our PowerPoint presenter today, and we need a little bit more help. You can't do it every single week or the week, so yeah, please, please. And if you don't have the skill, we'll train you up. So, you know, it's an opportunity for you to learn a new skill. The coordination crew lead and the community engagement lead, these are things that are really at the, again, at the crux of what we do. We have a coordination crew, and that forms a group of people that lead our events, but also the structure of Sunday Assembly and come up with all the ideas of new events as well. So if you feel like that could be something for you, I would advise to take a look at it. And then after this, there'll be a breakout room that Steph and Ange are gonna be in. So if you want to have more information or just want to talk about other opportunities, perhaps you've got ideas of your own, then please, please do go in there. That'll be at the end of the assembly today. But you could also reach out to us as well. And like I said, this is all on the our website, sundayassembly.com. So please, please do go and have a look. And some links are going in the chat as well. So connection. So we've talked about like different ways of we connect. And one of them is events and telling you about them and sharing them with you. And we've got some fabulous volunteers that don't just volunteer for Sunday Assembly. They go further afield and they put on loads of events. We've got Stu and Ange who are part of this, which is Trapped in Zone 1. And this is happening next Sunday. And it's to celebrate Earth Day. So and it's all about climate change, and it's going to be wicked. And it's an evening Zoom call, and I'm going to have, these are my notes for all of the things that are happening. I'm so sorry. But yes, it starts at 7 p.m. And again, we'll pop in the chat for links for that. We've got chat, check-in and catch-up on Wednesday. This is an opportunity for you to come. Now, the great thing is I can actually say this with pride and a huge smile on my face. This will be the last one that we will do of chat, check-in and catch-up online because we can meet in groups. Yay! So that's fantastic news. We're slowly getting there, guys. Then next up, we have got Helping Hand. Now, this is our next Sunday Assembly, which is on the 2nd of May. I'm afraid we'll be on Zoom for a few more assemblies still until the numbers can improve and get bigger, but we'll definitely continue with this. So a Helping Hand, this is this is next Sunday, Sunday the 2nd of May, and that's the bank holiday Sunday, and it's about a guy who helped the community by bringing together food packages at the worst of our time so far, during lockdown, of course. And he's going to tell us all about how that and his robotics background helped him do that. So I just want to make an announcement as well. And I know I'm going on a bit, but I hope that this will fill you full of joy. I'd really like to spotlight two people, James and Caroline, if possible. Thank you. So James and Caroline have been with Sunday Assembly for some time. They've been volunteering for us in many, many different ways. They support us. They give us a lot of love and a lot of time. And thank you so, so much. We are so happy to celebrate. Caroline is pregnant and they're expecting their child very, very soon. And only last week did they get married. Yes. And so they have the rings to prove it. So congratulations, guys. We've got a Sunday Assembly wedding and baby coming up. So that's fantastic. They've got married, they've had the service, but the wedding is in the motion of being planned. So congratulations, James and Caroline. We're looking forward to seeing loads of you three in the future. And thank you so much. Sorry, I get very excited. I think I'm really broody these days. Anyway, that's fantastic. So back on to some of the things that are happening with us. We've got a fundraiser coming up, and it's going to be part of Captain Tom 100. It's the same people that did the 2.6 challenge last year, and it helped us to raise so much money, and we really, really would love to, you to get involved. It's a bit of a video. It's short, I promise. So I'll let Stephen do the video for me. I think he has to go out and come back in again. Technology, it's still not seamless. I think he's gonna bring that up. Yeah, I see him nodding away. Thanks, Stephen. Thank you, Doki. Could talk over this, couldn't I? I'm so sorry, guys. I didn't realise there was no sound on that. But anyway, so what this is for us and what are we doing? So the idea is that obviously Captain Tom did his 100 thing and we are being challenged to do our 100 thing. And so we've got two things coming up. And I just want to show this because these PowerPoint slides are like a work of art. I think you'll be so impressed. My PowerPoint skills are fabulous. And it's exactly why I'm not on the PowerPoint team. But Stephen will need to stop that video and then move to the next slide. Sorry, Stephen. This is what I love about Sunday Assembly. It's exactly, you know, being radically inclusive and getting everybody involved, getting everybody engaged, learning new skills, but also, you know, being a community and supporting each other. So personally, all of these things that happen, they're not glitches. They're not anything wrong with them. They are us, being human. So I really value this. Thank you so much, Stephen. Yes, 100 minutes of dance with, I was going to say doctor then. I mean, he's pretty much a doctor in music, DJ Ian Joliet. Now, for those that you don't know, Ian Joliet is an amazing person, amazing human, but he also is a fantastic DJ and he's offered us music, oh my gosh, like in and out for all the time that we've been in existence, I think, as Sunday Assembly. And he's agreed to play 100 minutes of songs for us to dance to. And we're going to do this on Friday, the 30th of April from 7 p.m. A bit of a weird finish time, but you know, 100 minutes, I suppose it calls for a weird finishing time. But yes, this is going to be a fundraiser, so please do come along. And there's going to be loads of information that's going to be shared with you in the follow-up to this, but also I'll be sending an email around as a newsletter. If you're not part of the newsletter, you can go to our website. You can sign up to our newsletter as well. Again, that's sundayassembly.com. But we have also some fabulous community members that are coming together and we'd love you to join us for that as well. So if dancing isn't your thing and you want to do something else, then you can join us. And we are going to do, oh gosh, I'm like a drum roll, please. This is when you really want to be like multitasked with like a drum kit right here. Just getting ready for that next slide. And here it is. Yes, we will walk 100 miles. And if that song didn't come into your head, then there's something wrong. So 100 miles, we are going collectively, not one person. This bank, May bank holiday, we're going to do 100 miles between us all. We have, you know, we're going to tally it all up. We're going to choose a distance that's right. Well, you choose the distance that's right for you. You can do it with your friends, your family, you know, embrace the easing of lockdown. Have fun, take pics. And the whole idea is that, again, it's fundraising for Sunday Assembly. It's getting us back to Conway Hall. We want to go back. Those doors are for us to open as soon as we can, possibly can, but we need to get back there, definitely, and we need the funds to kind of help us also, so that when they do open, we can be in there, right in there. Okay, so, and then I suppose I would love to update you about the Community Fund. Now, for those of you that don't know or haven't heard me bang on about the National Lottery, earlier in 2020, well, actually quite late on in 2020, we got a grant. And that grant is going to help us to be more inclusive. And hopefully we will be able to share this with you as soon as we're able to go back in Conway Hall. And there are ways that we've been working on it so far. So, but I do want to say virtual stuff. If you can see that picture on Matt's lovely bed, that is all the tech equipment that we have bought from this with this grant money to help us go stay virtual and live stream when we're back in Conway Hall. So this community won't be lost. The connection and being around the world and being inclusive won't be lost. And that is exactly what that funding is for. However, there is also one thing that you may have noticed that we said today that we've never been able to say before. And that is that we've now got a captioner. And it's, I'd love to introduce Katja, who is now part of our captioning pool. We only have one at the moment, so we're looking for others to join her. But it's with thanks to Katja that we are able to have this facility of captioning. And unfortunately, we haven't been successful in getting a BSL interpreter, but this is equally amazing. Katja could come on her screen. I just like a little wave with Katja so you all know who she is. She's new to our community. And so this is, if she is, this is a fantastic opportunity to just say hi to Katja, who's typing vigorously away while all of us get excited and talk too fast. So sorry for everybody. Okay, well, you'll be all pleased to know that is me done, but I hope that you've found that all very exciting. Because there's a lot going on in our community and it's really, really exciting to be part of. So back over to you, Matt.
Thank you. Thank you. There was so many notices. And yet all I remember is that Annie is broody. thanks for that piece of information there. So we're coming to the end. We've got one final song, then we'll come back and explain the breakout rooms and things. And so we've got one final song, which is a song to dance along to. It was written after 1996, so I have no idea what it sounds like. But yeah, final song. Here we go.
Yes, I'm in the zone. It's a 2-3, leave a good tip. Let's go to the beach, each, let's go get a wave. They say what they're gonna say. Have a drink, clank, found the Bud Light. Bad witches like me, it's hard to come by. The Patron on, let's go get it on. The zone on, yes, I'm in the zone. It's a 2-3, leave a good tip. I'ma blow all of my money, it's on for two bits.
On the floor. I love to dance, so give me more, till I can't stand. Get on the floor, like it's your last chance. If you want more, then here I am. Starships were meant to fly, hands up and touch the sky. Can't stop, 'cause we're so high.
What?
'cause we're so high. Let's do this one more time. Oh, starships were meant to fly. Hands up and touch the sky. Let's do this one last time. Can't stop.
Requirement or nuts and over.
Touch the sky, can't stop, 'cause we're so high. Let's do this one more time. Oh, starships were meant to fly. Hands up and touch the sky. Let's do this one last time. Can't stop.
We're higher than a missile.
Steph singing there, brilliant, yes. So it works, still never heard it before because I'm too old. So now we're just going to go into breakout rooms. But before that, thanks everybody for being involved today. and now I've forgotten who everybody was. Thanks to John, thanks to Robin, thanks to Katya for doing the titles. Thanks to Rona, who's just had to leave, unfortunately. Thanks to Annie for the notices. So Steph's going to set up some breakout rooms. There's going to be a breakout room for people who want to volunteer for the roles that Annie was talking about. There's going to be a breakout room for first timers, and you should be able to choose them when they come up. And there's going to be other breakout rooms for just talking to random people. The good news is that John's back after his little sojourn away charging things after his talk. So I don't know if it's possible to set up another room to just talk to him about sciencey stuff as well. If not, he'll be in one of the other rooms. But that's it. That's it. Another Sunday assembly over. Breakout rooms. Then I'm going to the pub